much. How are you?
I'm okay. How are you?
Good, good. All right, so this is life study, our little sort of reason to hang out and draw and talk. Me and my good friend Mairin-taj Caya both do this every month.
Yeah.
We share it on our Patreons. Sorry, it's been a long weekend. And we just talk about various art subjects while we're drawing and modeling and doing all that art stuff that we do. So, you had a good weekend, despite the cold weather snap here in central PA.
Yeah.
It's all good?
Yeah, a little bit of St. Patrick's Day fun.
Nice, nice. I got to spend St. Patrick's Day with a real-life Irishman. Friend of mine, Declan Shelby, was in from Ireland at a show this weekend. Although he explained to me that St. Patty was actually Welsh, he's not even Irish.
Yeah.
I didn't know this.
No. He just came to Ireland and, like, you know, told them what's what with the whole thing.
Can't even get that right.
No.
He says if there were a saint, it should be St. Declan. I don't know how accurate that is, but
that would be a good choice.
Yeah. Anyway, we're here in central Pennsylvania. We're specifically in downtown Lancaster at the Pennsylvania College of Art and Design, who sponsors the show, specifically the illustration department.
Yeah.
They're kind enough to sponsor the show, give us a space to work. And I also happen to teach here. I teach anatomy and figure drawing. Mairin-taj is a graduate and an incredible artist and works here as a professional model. If you're looking for an art school, it's not a bad choice, especially if you want something a little more like tailored to a smaller group. That's always the thing I kind of think about this school. And also, the show is brought to you by Blackwing, who gives me pencils and stuff to use in the show. There'll be a link in the description if you want to pick up any of the pencils. So, Mairin-taj, last time we were together, we talked about this whole artist versus illustrator thing. And it came about through a conversation. I don't remember even where I was, but I was somewhere where a guy was asking me what I did.
Oh, in the park.
Oh, dog park.
Yeah.
Correct, you're right.
See?
That's why you're in. And I like gave him this whole spiel about all the illustration detail shit. Like, it was just a stupid, clumsy explanation.
Right.
And he just goes, oh, so you're an artist.
Yeah.
And I had to fight the urge to correct him because obviously to me, an artist and an illustrator are distinctly different. So, artist makes work and hopefully finds an audience for it after. Illustrators tend to have the audience already and are hired to make the work.
Yeah.
That's
definitely a good way to put that.
Yeah. Now, some people would probably call that, you know, artists and hacks. And that's okay. I'm okay with being called a hack as long as everybody eats. I'll deal with that.
Yeah.
You're sort of in the middle. We talked about this last show. You know, you're trained as an illustrator, but pretty like traditional art education,
for sure.
Right? Lots of figure drawing and stuff.
That's cool.
But you're probably more fine art inclined with some illustrator tools. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, I think in this landscape, this contemporary view of things, that's definitely a good way to put it. And also would help out that gentleman in the dog park, you know.
Yeah. Yes. And so we sort of left off with the whole debate, sort of neither of us really taking the bait and going, you know, one is better than the other.
Yeah.
But I think afterwards, you and I talked and you sort of felt like you still had ideas bubbling up about it, although it may not be something very concrete and specific, but you had a lot of thoughts on it.
Well, I just appreciate that it's such a big pool of a kind of conversation. And you know, if you guys are listening and you think you maybe disagree with something you say, or you know, have an opinion about what that distinction is between artists and illustrator, please, you know, let us know in the comments. That'd be cool.
Yes.
If there are any questions, I'd like to address them in the future episodes. So I think it's just interesting. Like, to your point, I was trained as an illustrator, and yet I don't really go by that now. And a big part of that is because the lay of the landscape in the world has changed with illustration and
right.
with art. And
right.
then another thought I had was like, well, being an artist, it's interesting that guy kind of recognized being an artist as a job, even.
Yeah, actually, that's a good point.
You know? And is being an art, like, is the artist in society fading? Certainly changing.
Yeah.
Dying out, being reborn, like, I don't know. So
yeah,
like, that interests me.
You're right. That's I wish I'd have thought of that. no, because I think of it very much as a job, and that would probably be incredibly offensive to most of the people I went to school with. You know, I remember them quite literally saying, like, craft was a dirty word, right? Like, the idea of being a draftsman is ridiculous. It's, you know, so...
How so?
I guess just because craft is, they sort of look down their nose at craft. Like, it's not... Like, learning a craft is for craftspeople. We're artists. We're not supposed to.
Oh.
You know what I mean? Which is always... I really hated that attitude.
Yeah.
But that's there. That's in the fine art world. And I think they see it as... It is not a job, and it's probably more akin to, like, a... I think a lot of fine artists are starting... Man, I'm going to get in trouble.
Well, but you're talking about artists?
Yeah, like artists. And it feels more and more like they're more of a brand.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. When you say a word twice, that means you really, really artists. You know, it feels more like a brand, right? Like, they're always, like, curating their image, and how do they look, and how does their work, is it in the right crowds, versus us, where we're, as illustrators, like, we're for the people. Maybe it's more like...
Oh, that's interesting. You know what that reminds me of?
Communism. Sorry.
No,
sorry.
Well, it may be a little off, but to me, it kind of cycles back. You want to start with 2 minutes?
Yeah, start drawing.
Okay.
If you've seen past shows, you probably realize that. Yeah, Mairin-taj and I just love hanging out, and we end up talking for a really long time and not drawing, so forgive me.
We'll start with 2.
Yeah, whatever works.
But the thing that just reminded me of the way you said is, I was listening to a style expert, and they were saying how old Hollywood used to have, like, actors and actresses, professionals in Hollywood that would create an aesthetic around them as an individual, like their brand. And nowadays it's more actors and actresses and celebrities are wearing other people's brands.
Correct.
And
That's true.
I was just, I don't know if that goes anywhere, but just sort of like the old world look of creating yourself as a brand and kind of representing your aesthetic, your values, everything as one package. Like, you are your brand. And you take that into the world and see where it kind of can serve.
Man, that's a great way to put it. Because I guess one,
The
artist used to lead the way. Well, I'd rather, I guess, the actors used to lead the way.
Yeah.
And then all of us sort of try to catch up. Wow, shit. See, that's great. And, someone's at the door. Sorry, this is a working art school we are in, so every so often you might hear students being students, so forgive me. I promise we won't charge extra for students being on. That's a great point, though.
So, I mean, when I was in school, artists, the art or fine art kind of perspective was more... The impression I got, being in the illustration department, was that fine artists were more, I guess, cliche, looking down your nose at the hired hand illustration.
Right.
But they were all about, like, I have to hone my craft. You know, I'm, you know, it was more of a proper artist thing to kind of, like, be really absorbed by their technique and their style and their brand and their aesthetic and their values.
Yeah.
Which I don't really have a problem with.
No, I mean, I remember there was like a look, for instance, for like sculptors.
Yes.
You remember, like, the overalls and all that stuff?
That's right. I didn't know. I didn't start yet. Okay.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
And it was, you're right. I mean, I don't do that enough. I don't think about it in terms of fashion. But there is a sense of, like, you know, artists were very keen. Maybe I shouldn't say were. Maybe they still are. To like curate what they, how they appear. Sorry, let me start that over. They curate how they look and how they come off to people in their audience. And it always seems silly to me because it's not about the work.
Mm.
but someone said something to me once that like bugged me, because I was always like sort of anti-brand, that whole idea of artists have to create a brand for themselves. And I don't remember where I heard it, but someone said something to the effect of, your brand is what people say about you when you're not at work. And I just thought, like, God damn it, like, I still have to worry about this, because as an illustrator, you do have to, I've often talked about, you know, like, I'm my storefront, and I have to worry about how people perceive me so that they trust me enough to give me projects to work on. And so the idea of having to worry about a brand because it's there, whether you cultivate it or not, is incredibly frustrating.
And then if it's there, whether you cultivate it or not, then maybe it's more responsible to cultivate it diligently, so that
yes.
you're kind of cultivating something you want as opposed to something that you're misleading people.
Correct, correct.
You know?
Makes me think of, God, I'm going to hate this comparison, but it makes me think of Machiavelli's The Prince, right? The idea that, like, you read that book and you go, man, this guy's fucking terrible, right? But, like, what he was trying to write was a way for good people to, I'm going to say good people in quotations, but to survive in this world that's incredibly treacherous.
Yes.
Right? So.
Yes.
Maybe there is something to that.
And I think artists are fundamentally like these tender, hard on their sleeve type people who have
yes.
to learn how to like fend for themselves and their work.
Correct.
In this messy, tragic world.
And a very exploitive world, right? Because everybody
yes.
wants the stuff we're making, but they don't necessarily want. Do you want a store or something to put your.
No, I'm good.
Okay. They don't want to pay for it necessarily. And you can say, well, it doesn't matter. Until you see your stuff on, you know, shirts or plates or something you didn't, you know, hadn't planned on.
Yeah.
So
There's have you ever heard of artists talking about like fall in love with your brand, like represent your brand, get high on your own supply?
Oh God, no.
Those concepts.
Oh no.
Get high on your own supply. Well, it's this idea of, you know, like, you know, carry around a mug with your own art, or wear a t-shirt with your own, like, aesthetic, or, like, kind of make product or represent your work in every kind of way. Just kind of get into what you do.
Yes.
Because that's the only way you can really teach people
okay.
to get into what you do.
Yeah, yeah, which I do a version of, like, we make t-shirts and
yeah.
mugs and things like that. And I always kind of excuse it as like, well, I'm already a hack. I might as well be a hack for myself.
Yeah.
But yeah. Sorry, when I hear you get hired on supply, I thought you meant in terms of like believing your own bullshit. You know what I mean?
No, I haven't heard of that iteration
okay.
before. But I heard get hired on your own supply from Andy J. Pizza is what he's.
Oh God, really? That's his name.
Yeah, I know it's kind of funny, but he's
yeah.
actually great. He's an illustrator and an artist, or a fine artist. He does his own stuff. He does a podcast. Check him out if you're interested in more cool art talk.
Andy J. Pizza, is that correct?
Andy J. Pizza, Creative Pep Talk Podcast.
Oh, I love it. Okay.
He's cool, but I like the idea of, you know, being an artist, being a creative, being a visual person.
Yeah.
You're already kind of an outcast in society, so you really, you know,
that's not depressing at all.
Well, you really have to like get into what you have to offer.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
no one else is gonna know how
for
to
sure.
do that for you.
Yeah, yeah. There's a documentary you should watch. It's called Supermensch.
Supermensch?
Yeah, yeah. So it's
no,
this
really?
Guy. It's the guy that was the I forget his name, but he was the agent for like Alice Cooper and all these people.
Oh, okay.
And he fell into it. He didn't like. He went out to LA to be a teacher at like an inner city school thinking he'd do some good.
Yeah.
And he literally got beat up the first day. They chased him off campus. And so he ended up at this hotel and he sees this woman at the poolside being raped. So he runs down there, grabs the guy, beats his ass.
Yeah.
Well, the woman starts beating his ass.
What?
Turns out she wasn't being raped at all.
Oh.
And it was Janis Joplin with her boyfriend poolside, just like this was a rock star hotel.
Oh.
It's full of like Jimi Hendrix is there. It's wild shit, right?
Oh,
so he falls into basically Jimi Hendrix says he asks him if he's Jewish. He says, yeah. He says, you ought to be an agent. Here, meet this guy.
Oh.
just it was kind of racist, but like,
uh-huh.
yeah, he ends up getting introduced to Alice Cooper and becomes his agent. And this guy is incredible. He's kind of scuzzy, let's be honest. But I mean, he goes on to represent, but he makes Alice Cooper who he is. He goes on to represent a bunch of R&B guys.
Wow.
He creates the idea of like a celebrity chef.
Oh, wow.
Before him, some chefs were like famous, but not wealthy.
Yeah.
So he's an interesting guy, and his entire career was that. It was like,
wow.
Hey, Alice, we can't sell concert tickets, so let's get a truck. They find out what's the like most touristy, busy street, which is Piccadilly Square, and like he gets a truck with Alice Cooper printed on the side and it's like underwear,
uh-huh.
and purposely tells the guy to stall the truck out so that it gets covered in the news. When it gets covered in the news, everybody's talking about Alice Cooper, and he ends up selling out at this concert in London. He just did that kind of, he's the one that came up with the whole killing a bird on stage thing.
Mm-hmm.
That was just like a pillow or something.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, it's a long tangent to say that his entire career was built on like creating and maintaining an image that was like true to the artist still. I mean,
yeah,
but like, yeah, but not, but in a way that artists probably would never do, right? Like he'd hire photographers to go, and he's like, I don't even care if there's film in the camera. Just show up, here's where he's gonna be. Show up and just like paparazzi take tons of pictures of him. And of course everybody around's going like, who's that guy? He must be famous.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it's shitty, but that's part of the business, I guess now. You know, only we're doing it on this big scale with Instagram and Twitter and all that stuff. So.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I'm sorry, I'm talking to you. I have a sort of horizontal thing.
Yeah, right.
So we're going to do a pose like that, maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, that works.
Well, that's the interesting thing there is, like, you can, and I don't want anyone, do you want to do 2 minute or 5 minute?
It's up to you.
Five?
Yeah, whatever you're comfortable with.
I wouldn't want to be misunderstood to advocate for
bullshit.
Basically being fake. Yeah, bullshit. Don't bullshit yourself.
Yeah.
But there's a quality of, you know, you can create, I don't like the term create your own brand, I'm not into that, but, you know, represent yourself as thoroughly and wholly, holistically as possible.
Or just get out in front of it sounds like you're
yeah.
saying, right?
Yeah.
Because it's going to happen anyway.
Yeah.
So maybe you need to make sure it's not some version of you that you don't feel is you.
Right. Kind of be proactive about
yeah.
How you exist as a creative in the world, which is of course easier said than done.
Yeah.
But and then so how does that fit in with, you know, being an illustrator who creates their own work, or being an artist who creates their own work versus being, you know, a hired hand as you put it,
yeah.
an illustrator or a graphic designer.
Well, it seems to me that there's still all that image making. I mean, being at the show, image making in terms of your personal image, not just making images.
Yes.
But, you know, you see these people who are, like, clearly being very mindful of how they're dressing and who they're talking to and, you know, do they give the right vibe off at the bar and are they meeting all the correct people? And there's definitely a lot of that, even in the sort of comics illustration TV world that
yeah.
we're in right now. It was funny because like I'm just now getting back into shows and there's always this like weird, you get this funny look like, oh, who is this guy? And is he important and do I need to talk to him? Not everybody does that.
Mm.
You know, I like to think that the people I end up hanging out with hang out with me because I'm just super cool, not because of who I am. But you see that calculation happening.
Yeah, that's
Yeah, and it sucks. Because they're aware of their image and they don't want to be seen with the wrong people. Like in that kind of cool person sense, which sucks. But they're all managing, like they're not just out making comics or movies or TV shows. They're also like working on their like, I don't know, their storefront / brand all the time.
Yeah.
Which is exhausting sometimes, unfortunately. But.
Mm.
And we borrow that from the fine art world, I think, frankly.
Borrow what?
A little bit of that mentality, like fine arts slash music world. I think we're, you know, I kept making a joke, like, what's the difference between a comic artist and a rock star? There are rock stars that don't think they're comic artists. You know what I mean? So.
Or private, like, celebrity chefs.
Yes.
Yeah, for sure. It's really interesting.
Yeah. I guess my point is that you're going to have to get out in front of it.
Yeah.
Whether you're a fine artist or an illustrator at this point, it's all sort of the same. I don't think there's the days of just being an illustrator in your studio and it's just the work that gets you noticed. I think those days are gone.
For sure. That definitely has been a big shift in the industry and in the world of being a creative. But I think it's important to kind of what I was saying earlier, you know, like what are you serving? Not just like who are you serving, but like what is your higher, like what are you about? What are your kind of mission, values, you know, like for me a big factor that's changing my creative work and how I make is me becoming more interested in like, okay, how do I serve the sustainability efforts in the world?
Right.
You know, like, so that's kind of a part of getting high on your own supply or getting motivated to serve a greater purpose, not just fanning your own vanity flames. That's not what it's about.
That's a great way to put it.
So.
Yeah. No, that's, unfortunately, I think that's probably, I shouldn't say unfortunately, that probably is the right way to deal with a world that's, you know, counting your Instagram followers.
Yeah.
Whether you're a visual artist or a musician or whatever. So.
Yeah, substance is important and we're lacking it.
Yeah. And, you know, let's face it, like, that's part of making art. Like, if you're making this hollow art, it's not going to sustain you long enough to build a career.
Right. Well, something that is it's so not in vogue right now in the art world, and especially with like social media and crap, but I really think artists need to slow the fuck down.
Yes.
Like, the process of making art, the what goes into, you know, what you psychologically ingest to then kind of put out again, like,
okay,
the process should be so much slower, because the work is getting shittier because it's like just cranked out.
Amen.
You know?
Amen, honestly. I catch myself doing it. I'm like, oh God, I should.
Yeah.
I gotta post something.
Yeah.
And then when I take a break from it, I just feel better. I mean, I just posted a drawing where I had kind of, it's not finished and it's just several stages, but I'm making myself slow the hell down. Because I do a lot of training where I'm doing at least one figure drawing a day, usually as many as two or three.
Yeah.
And they're kind of, you know, like they're fulfilling, but they're pretty quick.
Right.
Where I just told myself, I need to stop. It's been like a couple of weeks, I'm just, or at least a week on this one drawing, because I'm just doing what you were saying, just like
cranking
it out, because I have a follower base I have to feed, you know?
Yeah, and I think from my experience and my little bit of being online, I noticed that it really has made me miserable.
Yes.
You know, and the work suffers, and the what I'm trying to serve, the higher purpose of why I make work, suffers. It's not really addressed.
Yeah. Especially your work. I mean.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, like, we're not. I feel like artists, one of their higher purposes in life, and maybe this is too grandiose for some people, but I think we kind of we push and we elevate society to move forward.
Right.
You know, and like, we're not really helping humanity do that if we're just kind of catering to clickbait and scrolling and like, oh, just give me the next thing. Give me the next thing. Like,
Yeah, if your audience is looking at your work for, you know, what's the current number for, it's like less than 3 seconds or something in terms of people's attention span, how can you connect with them? Like, your stuff is just going to be one of millions of images they look at for that day.
Yeah, and it doesn't really nourish anybody. There's no soul to it, or nutrition, or whatever you want to.
I love that. There's no.
Maybe that's a bit of a rant that I went down.
No, I think, we're maybe not talking illustrator versus artist anymore, but in a way we're sort of talking just visual artists in the world in general, right? This conversation started by how a civilians saw the work.
Right.
And maybe this is part of that discussion, right? Like, why are we, we're focusing on the wrong thing when we're off fighting between we are better than those guys or vice versa.
Yeah, that's true. That's a good point too. Like, okay, if some random stranger was like, oh, you're an artist.
Yeah.
So the term artist is used amongst the, as an artist friend of mine refers to them as civilians. No offense to anyone who is one.
No.
the normies, as
yeah.
They also say.
Moments.
But like, how are, yeah, moments.
No, sorry. That's I'm sorry.
But, you know, like, okay, it's good for us to know how we're being perceived.
Yes. Yes.
What we're known as, what is not known about us.
Right.
How we need to educate. I don't know.
Or abandon, right? Because there's going to be like.
Yeah.
This is going to sound weird from an educator, but I almost never want to educate. Like, I'm very quickly backing out of stuff when the philosophy is such that, like, I don't want to try to convince you of my worth, because that's already a losing battle.
Yes, thank you. Yes.
So,
yes.
I'd much rather just preach to the choir, and if you get it, you get it. If you don't, you don't.
Right, because at the end of the day, you know, everyone's growth is at a different level, at a different pace, and people are going to get what they're going to get at their own time and in their own way.
Correct.
So, you know, it's really out of your hands.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, like, we have a, I was a few years back, I spent a summer in Greece, and I drew somebody's portrait, and I had heard in the past from a friend of mine, he's like, man, you go to Europe, and, like, they may not all be able to draw, but their visual vocabulary is such that they can still talk to you about it in a way that you only expect artists to do here.
Okay.
And I was like, yeah, that's probably bullshit, but whatever, you know, I didn't argue with them. And then I'm in Greece, and I'm doing this portrait of someone just for fun, like, and people would come in and go, like, oh, her nose is too long. Just, like, one guy was a cabinet maker. He goes, her like, the brow is too, like, too wide, or I forget what he said, too long, something like that. And I'm looking at this, I'm like, god damn it, they're funny. And they just have, I think they have that visual literacy from having to look at things slowly for, you know, most of their history.
Yeah,
I think we look very quickly at things, you know, like.
In the West?
Yeah, well, I mean, I shouldn't say the West, but in the United States, for sure.
Right.
There's not a, there's no part of the education system. I mean, there are art classes, but I mean, let's face it, they're the first to go.
Yeah.
When times are hard, and even in them, they're sort of like, you're babysitting people. Like, they're not actually stopping and making you, not that they don't want to, but they don't get to actually talk to students about really, really studying things. I mean, how do you take a bunch of, say, high school kids and say, I just want you to stare at this figure and think about the proportions of it. So, like, they're just going to get bored and move on. But it's also cultural, I think. You know?
I agree with that for sure. I really do. And I think, personally, I think we could really all become a little bit, we could benefit from a cultural value of slowing down, ingesting more carefully.
Yes.
I don't know, like a philosophical mastication.
Mastication. Yes, please don't get that. Just in case the mic is too far from you.
You know, chew your food more.
I agree. My God, yeah, that's a great way to put it. Yeah, because you don't absorb any of it when you're just like wolfing it down.
Yeah. Right. And then you get
stomach cramps. There you go. And then you're full of crap, and everybody's like, oh, God, that guy stinks. Sorry.
No,
I'm gonna stop. I'm going to stop.
Yeah, that's true. I started it. I'm sorry.
No.
I always go there.
It's okay. I'm all for it. I don't know how we get anybody to change, though. I don't think we have. When this podcast blows up and they're showing it on like people will listen to us, and America will change.
Well, you know, and that's part of, for me, like, you know, I'm not here to be a missionary for anything. You know?
No,
like,
no.
There's just a, all right, I gotta speak my piece and what I know, and then, you know, if it hits anyone, great.
Yeah, yeah.
If I miss my mark, fine. Got to get better at it.
Yeah, I had a professor used to tell us, like, you know, if 2% of your audience understands, and he meant with art, but I think it carries over to anything.
Yeah, right.
He says 2% of your audience gets what you're talking about, then that's a win.
Yeah.
So maybe 2% of people will go out there and proselytize. We'll start a church, church of figure drawing. You'll be the high priestess.
I always loved the Egyptian.
Yes. Yes.
Well, I mean, something you said earlier too reminded me of back in school. I don't know. Maybe it's outdated, but I kind of liked walking around a building, a facility of different types of artists, different types of makers and creators, and different genres, and like you could tell. Was kind of in what camp just from their aesthetic.
Yes.
That was
kind
of cool, you know?
Yeah, oh my God, I miss that so much. So my campus, we had everything from, so we were a big painting school, but we had everything from like textiles to jewelry making to glass making, and you really could see like, oh, those are the sculptors.
Yeah.
The glass makers were way off in the corner, so they were like foreign tribe that no one ever saw. You know what I mean? Unless they needed more glass and they popped up somewhere, or a pack of cigarettes at the store.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you're right. And then the artists, the painters were everywhere, and they were always full of shit.
And they were always covered in paint.
Yes, yes, and like.
And then looking kind of wistfully at the stars.
Yeah. and then there's the performance artist guys.
Yeah.
They were the worst. No, I shouldn't say the worst, but they were the. Just the most screwball in terms of the goofy stuff they were trying to do.
Right, kind of always riffing.
Yeah, yeah. So I do miss that for sure. And I went to another art school where, when I went the first time, my roommate was an opera singer, and he sings with a Philharmonic. I don't want to say where, because I don't want to, but it was just awesome. Like I remember, it was my birthday, so it was over the summer for part of the program, and. I turn this corner and I hear this guy's voice was insane. Like, I remember going to one of his performances and looking up the road and it's all girls and they're all crying.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was like, dude, that's a superpower.
Yeah.
But I turn the corner and he's singing Happy Birthday in Spanish, but like in this kind of, you know, beautiful operatic voice. And I just thought, like, I'll never have this again.
Yeah.
Like, there's no part of the world that is like, this moment in time is unique and special, and yeah, it was pretty amazing.
What a special moment.
Yeah.
It
just
that.
Got to actually draw ballet dancers at, like, on stage, and then, yeah, it's like, when's that going to happen again? Yeah.
I love that, because it's, I mean, some people maybe misunderstand that as, like, I'm not advocating for segregation, but...
No, hell no.
You know, when you kind of see all the different options, all the different groups,
yeah,
that's not really
yeah.
the word, but you know, like all the different ways, then you kind of get a better sense of maybe
yeah.
what your way is.
Yeah.
And then you kind of get a sense of how they can collaborate.
Yes, and you get this feeling from the person making the art. Like,
yeah.
I was really good friends with this guy who was a trumpet player. And we're at about 35 minutes, so maybe one or two more.
Okay.
And he was not a super handsome man, but he was like really popular with girls, and I was always like, I thought that's cool. Like they actually, you know, they don't care about how he looks; they just care about the person he is.
Mm.
And then, and I sat in on one of his classes. Like he asked me, he taught like an improv thing.
Oh, cool.
And I sat in on it, and he's playing, and he's talking about playing, and I'm like, holy shit! I think I have a crush on this guy. Like, you can't help but, you know, that's. I guess part of that brand making, he wasn't trying to do that.
No.
Like, you couldn't help just, here's this guy who just, we have long, straggly hair and glasses, and just not a cool guy, but man, he starts talking about his art, and you're just like, I'm fluttering my eyelashes at this guy.
Well, that's, I mean, we're attracted to, as people, as human beings, like, we're drawn to genuine confidence.
Yes.
Which comes from kind of knowing who you are and what you're about and passion.
Yeah.
You know, conviction.
Absolutely.
So, like, it's not about popularity, it's about passion.
Right, right.
If you want to, like, that's a nice mnemonic device, the PP.
Yeah. Yeah, and I never understood it until I met this guy. You know, because, you know, as a guy, you're always like, you're like, you know, we were young and everybody's always talking about girls and, but you know, I was like, well, you know, how like these kind of nerdy dudes end up with pretty girls or just any girl?
Yeah.
And I realized that, like, oh, it's because women pay better attention.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and when I was forced to, because I was in this class, I'm like, now I finally get it.
Mm.
So that's not me coming out of the closet. I'm just saying. I get it now. This guy was incredibly charming, and if you're out there still doing, I'll send you my number. No, I'm just kidding.